This company, the Tourage Boreur, actually is like a few in a world, actually. The Boremont Tourage Boreur is from Normandy, from Normandy. What they do, just to understand the process, the cream is being brought to a certain temperature, bring down until all the molecules actually are combined all together. It's like, for example, tempering chocolate. It's like tempering chocolate. That's why the butter is so elastic, pliable, easy to use. Just to recap, so the Tourage Boreur, between the elasticity, the plasticity, and the higher melting point, actually has a direct impact to the final product. We're talking about the volume, the crispiness, and the flakiness, and also about the shelf life. Okay, so next, I'm going to talk about the croissant dough, the ingredient, what we use, and all that. So the croissant dough is not all about, it's not all about the recipe, and it's all about, of course, the ingredient, what we use, and also is tempering temperature, controlling the temperature, the fermentation, and everything. So basically, first of all, you need, like, of course, the flour. A flour, you need like a high gluten flour. Personally, I don't pretending to have the best recipe for the croissant, but this one is working really well for me for many years, and sometimes I tweak around with some ingredients, but this one is really wide. So you need to find a good high gluten flour. Personally, I'm using the Grand Moulin de Paris, and which is great for the viennoiserie, for every viennoiserie between the brioche and all that. So the what you need to know about the flour, the high gluten flour, you need to have a certain percentage of protein. You need between a 12% to 14% of protein, which is important. If it's sometimes for the flour, for example, for the panettone, some flour is a 30% protein, which is high in protein. So you need to adjust your recipe. So basically, the protein is on the bag. And if it's too high in protein, you can add some AP flour, is a low protein. So like that, you can adjust the recipe. Okay. So I put in a bowl. So you need to use a bowl, and with actually with a hook. So I'm gonna explain that later. Then, of course, I'm gonna talk about for the recipe. I'm starting with 1 kilo flour. It's gonna be more easy for explain. Then you need some yeast. Usually fresh yeast is great. You need 40 grams yeast for 1 kilo, especially on a winter time, right? Like right now in New York, you need like 40 grams. On a summertime, you could go down to 30 grams for 1 kilo. And some people, it depends where you live, if it's warm or what, you can go. It's usually it's between 25 grams to 40 grams for 1 kilo. And right now, I'm using the dry yeast because I don't do viennoiserie every day, so I don't want to waste on the yeast. So the dry yeast, if you use a dry yeast, you need to use a half of the amount. So basically, for 1 kilo, is a 20 grams. So 40 grams for the fresh yeast, 20 grams for the dry yeast. So you put inside the mold. Then, of course, you need some sugar. The sugar is basically for the taste, for the coloration, but also it could be your enemy for yourself, especially for the dough, for the gluten, actually, because actually it's good to soften the dough. If you add too much sugar, it's good to soften the dough, and also it's good to slow down the fermentation. So for 1 kilo, personally, I'm using 110 grams of sugar. The recipe usually is between 100 grams to 130 grams, but you need to go easy on the sugar, like I said, because the sugar, too much sugar is going to attack the gluten, and it's going to become a weak, actually. Then I'm adding some neuvelin, which is an invert sugar, or trimolin. If you don't have like a nerveline or tremoline, you can substitute with the honey, which is both invert sugar. But with the honey or the nerveline, it's not about the. You need to. It's very high on the sugar level. It's like compared to the regular sugar, it's 130% more sweet than the regular sugar, which is a high content of sugar. So this one, I want to use the tremoline or the honey. It's not for the taste. It's not for the coloration. It's to retain the moisture, actually. And also, it's going to extend the chef life of your croissant. So I'm just adding to the top, to the sugar, just like that. Then the salt. The salt, actually, this one, of course, is going to boost, is a boost of flavor, is going to boost the flavor of the butter, which is very important. And actually, I'm using 25 grams, which is a maximum. Usually, most of the people using 20 grams, I like to use 25 grams again, because it's going to help the, it's going to help actually the gluten, because the sugar is going to attack the gluten. So you need some boost. Actually, is your friend, actually. The salt is, this is your friend compared to the sugar. All right, so I'm gonna add like 25 grams with the salt. Then I'm gonna add some butter. Actually, the butter is not for the, it's not for the taste or the flavor. The butter, actually, you could add like in pieces, just like that. I put 10% to 1 kilo. So basically the butter is going to improve the shedability when you do the lamination, okay? It's not for the, like I said, it's not the flavor, it's just to improve the shedability during the lamination. Just like that, cold butter, big piece like that, and it's going to work well. Also for the butter, I'm using 10% for 1 kilo. You could go 5% to 20%, which is a maximum, okay? Again, on the butter, we need to go on the slow side, or otherwise it's going to slow down also the fermentation, okay? Then I'm adding some scrap de croissant, what I did yesterday, or sometimes I freeze them, and adding the leftover when you do the croissant, the pain au chocolat, everything, same thing, I'm adding 10% to the dough. It just, that is going to, the flavor is going to boost also the fermentation, which is great, just like that in pieces to the dough. Then on my recipe, I'm putting some milk. Actually the milk, of course, beside the coloration, is not, personally, it's not for the coloration I'm looking for with the milk, actually. It's going to give you a rich tasting dough, actually, after it's baked, the croissant. Also, when it's baked, the croissant, the dough will be more soft and it has more bodiness, actually. It's very interesting with the milk. So for 1 kilo of the flour, I'm adding 180 grams of milk, okay? And then I complete the dough with the water. Actually, you need to use a filter water or bottled water. So usually there's 320 grams of water. For the liquid, for 1 kilo, usually it's between 45 to 50% liquid to the dough. Then again, it depends on your flour too. Sometimes it can be 45% of the liquid. Sometimes it will be more than 50%. So you need to adjust over the time, the recipe, and every day is different. It depends on the weather, the temperature outside. This is for the dough. So, which is important when you make the dough is to control the temperature. It's very important if you're using the bowl mixer and all that, what I recommend, you can put your bowl mixer with a hook directly to the fridge overnight, and which is cold. And then, after you adding all the ingredients, make sure the milk the butter, the water is cold. It's very important because at the end of the mixing, you want the temperature of the croissant between 22 to 24 degrees Celsius, okay? If you have some spiral mixer, of course, you cannot put that in a fridge overnight. Some people using some ice instead of the water, and dough during the mixing is still really cold, actually, which is very, very important. You need to control the temperature of the dough. So what I do, so I go on the first speed, and I'm adding the liquid and ingredient. I'm going to work the dough with a hook for 10 minutes first speed. Then after for 2 minutes second speed, okay? And then after you need, now I don't check anymore because I know the temperature, the feeling and all that, but sometimes when I wonder, you need to take the thermometer and to check out your temperature if it's at 24 degrees Celsius maximum. Otherwise, it's going to start some fermentation and the dough after is going to be more heavy on the result of the product. Okay. So next. Sorry. So when the dough is ready, when the dough is ready, it need to be firm. Make sure do not overmix the dough, otherwise it's going to get elastic and stiff. And after it's going to be hard to work with it. So you just roll, if you do like a big batch, you divide the dough, and you do some ball. Usually I don't use any flour. I don't want to bring more gluten to the dough. You just on a marble very gently, you form a ball. And then after that, what I do, you plastic wrap actually the dough. And personally, you can put like three different balls and I put a chipan on top of it. Why? Because it's going to degas the dough, the bubble is going to take off. And like that, when you go to incorporate the butter during the lamination, it will not crack and it will be perfect. Actually, you'll have a perfect layer. So that is usually the dough I leave outside for, again, between 15 to 30 minutes. 30 minutes will be the maximum. It's going to be maximum that. Then on a winter time, if it's a summertime, usually I leave the dough for 5 to 10 minutes. Again, it's depending, you know, the environment where you're working, if it's warm or not, because you don't want to activate the fermentation. Why? Because the yeast is not a bread dough. The yeast, as soon you put into the flour and you start mixing, the yeast start to run the marathon. So you need to go slow. So you need to refrigerate overnight. It's very important. You want the yeast activate when during the proofing and the baking, so not before. So that is very important to control that. So the dough, after like today, which is called in New York, I'm gonna leave that for half an hour, actually outside, just like that outside. When it's on the chipper on top, is actually deflect, is kind of is becoming flat. What I do after the results. Then the bowl after, what you need to do is to take a rolling pin. Actually, you start with rolling pin to roll it, and you can, if you have a lot of dough, finish up to the shiller actually, and you need to make a rectangle piece like that, very flat, which is really important. Again, you don't want any gas, any bubble, so you need to press down the very, you need to be very strong for that. You do a rectangle. So I did like a 1 kilo dough. It gave me 1 kilo and 900 grams of dough. And then inside, I'm going to incorporate 1 kilo of the tourage butter for the recipe. So the dough, you keep flat, a plastic wrap actually, and then I put in a freezer. I put it in a freezer like that. I cut off the fermentation when it's really hard, and I put it out overnight to the fridge to 4 degrees, and the day after I can start to use it. That is very important. I can see some people do some bowl and keep in a fridge after it's poofing, I mean, and the fermentation start all over, and then you have some gas, some bubble. After, it's very hard to do the perfect lamination. So, okay, the dough I'm gonna put back to the fridge actually. So the butter, we have a two size for the butter. We have the 1 kilo and the 2 kilo. 1 kilo and 2 kilo, actually, we are the only company in the US carrying the 2 kilo. The 2 kilo is a big advantage, actually, especially when you do mass production. Some people does like 30 to 50 patons a day, which is sometimes they do 10 patterns a day. If you do 30 patterns a day with a 1 kilo, you cut down to 15 patterns a day, so which is great. And is less labor intensive actually, and is very appropriate. So the butter, like I said, is from Normandy. It's from Normandy, and actually it comes frozen. Soon after it goes to the fridge, you have 4 months chef life, actually, for more chef life, and it's easy to use. So to use it is, well, actually, the plastic is really firm, actually, and I'm going to explain that later on. Okay, let's start the process for the croissant, for the lamination. Yes, please.
Okay. All right. Our first quiz question. The first person to answer this by chat gets the cutting board. This is a butter of what percentage? What percent is the butter? I said this during my introduction. Answer on the chat, please. And then, Eric, we also have a question. We have someone in England. Let me look at the question one more time. The question is, if they don't have access to Novolin sugar, is there an alternative? Is there a substitute?
Yes, the honey.
Honey,
yes. Okay. The honey is a substitute, actually. It's an invert sugar. It's a substitute, actually. Okay. So I'm going to start talk about the lamination, which is to incorporate the butter, which is an important step. The very important thing, actually, is to before to start with the butter and all that and the dough. I've been learned from a decade, you know, it has to be cold between the dough and the butter and the same texture. But it's very important to have a good temperature, actually, the dough, the right temperature, even the butter before to use it. To be honest, to have a perfect result or lamination and elasticity to use the butter with the dough and to get everywhere, actually, to have a perfect that, the dough should be between 2 to 4 degrees Celsius, and the butter should be between 9 to 11 degrees Celsius, which is really cold. And the dough right now is really cold, and this one is actually 2 degrees Celsius, which is perfect. And the butter, again, should be between 9 to 11 degrees Celsius. And I'm going to start to actually right now is a 9 degrees Celsius, which is great. So what I'm going to do, you see, with the butter, actually, it's like the plastic is thick, actually. It's designed for that, actually, just to, because before that it was in a paper and it can broke and you can find into the, actually, to find in the dough. You just have to open like that, you see, and it's easy, and how to take off the butter. And usually I'm using the paper to work with the butter. The butter, you cannot use straight the butter from just like that from the bar. You need to work actually with the shear just to get actually the perfect actually texture. And so the temperature I know is great. I just want to do like a rectangle, and I'm gonna cover with the dough over here. So I'm over here. So this is the butter, okay? This is the size of the butter, and I'm gonna pass that to the shear. Okay. I want like a 15 inch actually long, because my pattern, the dough block is a 15 inch long, just like that, which is good this way. So you see the butter is very pliable, elastic, and it's very easy to use it. Okay, so now I'm gonna do with the dough. So I just go to make sure the dough is flat and even before to add the butter. The dough is also, right now is a 3 degrees Celsius, which is great. Like I said, it has to be between 2 to 4 degrees Celsius. The butter is a 9 degrees Celsius. So I'm gonna extend the dough just a little bit. The dough is really cold, and also the dough is firm too, which is important. If it's too soft, the butter go through that, and it's gonna be difficult to use with. Here we go. So now, just to show you, here we go. So this is the pattern, the dough. And I'm gonna add the butter just on the middle, just like that. If it goes away, the butter, that's fine. I'm adjusting actually the butter. And then I'm go over the butter. And this dough goes all over the top of the other one. When I pile just like that. And the butter, if it goes outside, that's fine. And then with the rolling pin, I'm gonna adjust like that. Okay. Here we go. So the next thing, which is an important thing, a lot of people do that too. So I'm gonna cut through the folding side dough with a knife, just like that, very deep. Why? Because you want to release the stress from the gluten, actually. Also, the butter is going to spread more even actually everywhere. And also you're going to improve the lamination. So just like that. And then I start on the shilling. Okay. I'm gonna this one, this side. Here we go. Here we go. So now I'm going to do like a start with a one double turn, and then I'm going to proceed with a one single turn. I can explain that. So I'm cutting the edge to make sure to make more even. So that is not wasted, actually. What I do, I'm using for making, actually, I keep in a freezer or the fridge if you want to make some dough with a scrap like I did on a recipe. Just like that. As you see, the butter, the plasticity, the elasticity is great actually. Yeah, the temperature is perfect. The butter is spread everywhere actually. Just like that. What I do with a double turn, just like that. Then over here. And I'm going to press actually just tiny like that. So if you have like a two or three pattern to do it, you could do right away the second turn because the dough again is cold, it's really cold. So you can actually work at the same time to make the double turn and single turn at the same time. Otherwise, if you have like many pattern to do it, what I do, usually, I do one double turn, I put on a chipan freezer, and I do the other one, and et cetera, et cetera. And then after, when you finish the double turn, you take the first one, and then after, I'm going to start the single turn. So the same thing for the single turn. You see the folding side from the pattern. I'm going to cut through same thing on the side with the knife. Again, is to release the stress of the gluten, to improve the lamination. Just like that. I did this one and the other side too, just on the middle, just like that. Okay, you see? And then I'm giving it the single turn right away. There you go. Here we go. So same thing. Upcutting just the excess to make perfectly actually square. So for that, again, it's no waste. So it's a two way to use that. Some people, they use that for to make the pattern when they do the Allemand croissant, because the Allemand croissant doesn't need to be too nice, so which is working really great. If you don't want to use in for the Allemand croissant, you can use also for the pain au raisin. If you want to use for that, what I do sometimes, mostly all the time, for the single turn, adjust. Adding actually the excess of the dough, just like that, in broken pieces. Like that is no waste. Everything is usable on the dough, everything. Okay, and then I do the single turn, just like that. As you can see, I don't know if you see, the butter is everywhere, actually, all the layer, and it's not like broken pieces and all that. So it's actually the perfect actually square for that. And from that, I'm going to plastic wrap and keep in a freezer at least for half an hour. Then after that, I'm going to remove from the freezer to the fridge for 15, half an hour. And after it's ready for the shipping for the croissant. So
we have two quick questions from the audience. Is now a good time?
Yes, please.
All right. Question one, does the dough need to pass a window pane test prior to the 30 minutes of rest at room temperature?
No, no, not for a croissant. It's not a bread.
Okay, great. And the second question is, can you briefly go over what brand the dough sheeter is and how to use it, such as adjusting the thickness?
Okay, that I'm using actually the Rondo, which is a really well-known brand, actually. You have different sizes of sheeter. And this one is a tabletop. And you can have like with a wheel. So it's many brand for that.
Okay. One last question, actually. The maximum amount of butter to dough ratio.
Okay. So me, I'm using 26% actually of the butter for 1 kilo of the flour is the dough ratio. Some people go to 20%, which is really low. Personally, it should be between 25% to 30%, which is a good amount actually of butter. And this one is a 26% of butter. Also, talking about the turn, whatever, I got a lot of questions actually. Some people do a swing, three single turns, some people two double turns, and I used to do in the past two double turn, but a couple years ago, I do one double, one single turn. Why? I'm gonna cover that. So when you do one double turn and one single turn, you have a 25 layers, okay? When you do two double turn, you have a 33 layers. And some people go three single turn, which is have 55 layers. And the reason the 25 to 55, just to, if you want to compare to picture actually the thing, you take actually two books, the same size, actually the same thickness with the 25 page and 55 page. So at the end of the result is actually better to see the 25 pages because it's bigger actually the layers than the 55 pages. The three single turn with the 55 pages is going to be inside more dense, actually, like a brioche. It's not a brioche, but it will be more dense. And but at least the shelf life will be longer, but it will be a more dense croissant. With actually with a one double, one single, which actually the shelf life will be shorter, but will be more airy, more light, actually more bubble inside, and it's more interest. Actually, most of people do one double, one single, and two double, it will be a little bit more dense, but not too many difference for that. So after it depends how you want to work with, that's a trick about that. Okay. Also, with the tourage butter, of course, for the vinaigre, I cover that for the croissant, the pain au chocolat, the pain au raisin, the almond croissant is great. Also, if you do brioche feuilletée, is a lamination dough with a yeast dough, is amazing too. I'm suggesting to use the tourage butter for the brioche feuilletée, and also, of course, the puff pastry. The puff pastry is great for that. So to use the tourage butter, okay? So this one, I'm gonna plastic wrap after and put in a freezer and keep in the freezer for at least half an hour. So I did some dough this morning just to make sure it's ready. Like I said, I put in a freezer for half an hour, and then it's been refrigerated for half an hour, 45 minutes, which is fine. Then after that, I'm gonna cut it just to show you the layers. Okay, I don't know if you see the layers actually. It's okay. Okay. So actually it's perfect actually. So you have like a different layers, okay, of butter and dough. The butter is good to help, is like a barrier to the water steam. So during the baking, actually the water content in a dough change to gaseous state, and the steam actually goes to expand and separate the dough. It's going to create you the volume, the crispiness, the chef life, etc., etc. So that is very important to have a perfect layer during the proofing, which is great actually for the tourage butter, like I said, because using to compare a regular butter, you see for the lamination, to incorporate the butter was easy, is ready to use. This butter, some people are using, you need to tap with a rolling pin to make it flat. But the thing is the water content is very high. And sometimes also it's not flexible. You don't have the plasticity like the tourage butter. You can have some issue during the proofing and baking, like I was mentioned earlier with the tourage butter. The tourage butter has a higher melting point. This one don't have the higher melting point. So basically when the steam goes with the tourage butter is going to hold on longer than this butter. So with this product, actually with the regular butter, you might be some during the proofing, it might be deflect the croissant, even the baking, and you will have the product will be more heavier, actually less flaky, and also the chef life will be less actually appropriate. Okay, and there is a it's more easy to use the tourage than this one. Then I did also some food cost actually, because of course the tourage butter is more expensive than the regular butter. Like I said from the beginning, they use a different technology, machineries, a few people making this tourage butter compared to the regular butter. The food cost for a croissant scaling 80 grams, usually it's between 70 to 85 grams a croissant. So I did the food cost not with the labor, using the regular butter. So one croissant 80 grams cost me on the food cost 21 cents. And with the 2 kilo butter, the tourage butter, 80 grams of croissant cost me 27 cents. And 1 kilo is a 30 cents. The 2 kilo is a lot cheaper than the 1 kilo. But after, when you add up the labor and of course the labor intensity actually to make the thing happen, after you were talking about a few pennies. Okay, it's very convenient to use the tourage versus the other one. Okay. Then this is for the dough. So the dough actually is really cold actually, and is no fermentation. And I'm gonna pass that to the chiller to make some croissant. Okay. I don't know if you notice during my lamination, when I did the layers with the butter, the baton and all that, I didn't add any flour. Because everything is cold, everything's controlled, and usually it's passed through. Of course, when it's warm, you need to add some flour, but less you put flour, better you have a result. You don't add any gluten, which is great for that, okay? So for the croissant, here we go. So what I do for the croissant or the pain au chocolat, I trim actually the edge. And after on the this one, of course, I keep it to make the dough or the almond croissant with the scrap and all that. So that is very important. Just like that. And then after, for the size, the croissant is everyone. Personally, I do a 3.5 inch by 11, actually. And the croissant usually scale around, like I said, 80 grams. And on the chiller is like number three on the chiller, actually. Okay. Again, the strap, I'm gonna tell you also what I do also. Again, for the almond croissant, the pain au raisin, or not that, what I do, sometimes what you could do also, if you have a bakery or shop, you can put that in a freezer or fridge and you cut them into like dice, actually, just like that. And then you put them into a bowl, you keep in a fridge or freezer when you have a big amount, and you toss it with some cane sugar, and you can add some chocolate pieces, some dry fruit, and then after you take some muffin mold, and you just put some butter, and you fill up 2/3 to the mold, you puff it and bake it. It looks like a kind of a Queen Anne or something like that, and some people actually put some jam, and you can put some hazelnut paste or fill up with some custard, which is very interesting. And you can sell by the piece at least by $5 the piece, which is very interesting, with the strap actually. It's another vinaigrette. So with the croissant, dough. So So when you do the croissant dough, you need to, you roll it. You don't press too much. You roll really gently. You don't want to smoosh it. Otherwise, of course, otherwise you go to, if you press too much, you extend too much, you go to broke the layers. And during the proofing, you know what I mean? It's going to be dense and all that. So like that. Just, okay, very gently. And the tip goes to the bottom. Otherwise, the during the proofing, the curl goes away. Just like that. You see, I got no flour. I got no flour, which is fine. We are working is around 70 degrees Fahrenheit, which is great. Just like that. So the I want to come back to the butter before you. You need to have a system to have the temperature for the butter. For me, the system over here is working really well. The dough, usually when I come in, when I come in the day after, is around 4 to 5 degrees. What I do, I put back into the freezer to put down the temperature. It's really quick. And the butter from the fridge from outside, which is over here 70 degrees Fahrenheit, is ready in 15 minutes. So it's really quick, actually. The butter is will be between 9 to 11 degrees. And then after you can start your lamination right away and with a perfect texture. Just like that. Here we go. So from that, of course, you can proof it. Otherwise, if you don't want, of course, if you want to do like a big production, if you want to do your like a big production, you put them in a freezer. You stock them just like that. You put it in a freezer and the shelf life in a freezer because after the yeast maybe affect the yeast during the freezing time for 3 to 4 days. 3 to 4 days shelf life, and then after the proofing. So the proofing is an important, actually, stage.
Eric, can I jump in with a couple of questions?
Please.
So question from the audience. One question is that Janine sees that you are not cooling on the dough or making a slit. Why is that?
I don't make what?
You're not making a slit.
Yes. I don't make that because it's not necessary. If I want to make a slit with the dough, after you do the curling, you do the curl croissant. So you don't need to do that. You don't want to do that. Besides, if you want to do the curled croissant, yes, you want to cut the dough.
Okay, another question yes. is, if you're not using a butter sheeter, how thick do you make the dough?
Okay, the dough, what, at the end of the process?
I believe so, yes.
Before to incorporate the butter?
Yes.
Okay, the dough, it was like 2 centimeter thick, actually, for 1 kilo of flour.
Okay.
Okay.
Great. And then one or two more questions here. Let me bring them up. Noof, I know you had a question. Let's see here. Moment. Noof was also asking about the thickness of the dough as well as the butter. So I think you talked about that a little bit.
Yes.
Okay.
So the thickness of the dough is maybe I said it is on my sheeter is number three.
Okay.
For to cut the croissant.
There was that question. There's also a question about the brand of the butter that you're using.
The brand of the butter?
Yeah.
Is Beurmont. The Beurmont entourage butter, okay. For the pain au chocolat, the thickness on the sheeter will be number 4. Okay, it's more thick actually. You want to see the layers. As you can see, it's a nice layer, so it's going to proof really well. So the proofing stage is an important one actually. So if you want to proof right now, so your proofing box should be between 25 degrees Celsius to 27 degrees Celsius. That's the max. 27 is the max. Why? Because up to 27, of course, the butter starts to melt, you know, and it's over. So also, you need to incorporate some humidity. So the usually, to have a perfect proofing, you need to, on the proofing box, you should regulate 80% humidity, which is great, actually. Okay, 80% humidity. I don't have like a proofing box regulator and all that. So I have like an oven with a hot box, actually. What I do, I bring to boil some water, actually, and I put into the hot box. And I just want to make sure with the thermometer, the hot box, again, is between 25 to 27 degrees. And I incorporate some humidity. So the humidity need to be 80%, very intense, because you don't want some crust on top. And then the proofing time, again, is going to depend. It's going to be sometimes 1 hour and 45 minutes to 2 hours and a half. Again, it depends the weather, the temperature, how cold was the croissant and all that. Like I did a fresh like that, I'm sure in 1 hour and 45 will be ready. If you freeze the croissant and after you defrost and you put in a proofing box, it will be between 2 hours to 2 hours and a half, okay? Any question for that? No? So what I did, those one was poof, actually, was like a 1 hour ago. I put them into the fridge just to stop the fermentation and they kind of firm. And then this is the egg wash. Usually I'm using the spray gun, actually. It's more consistent and fast, actually. Otherwise, using the brush for the egg wash. It's a mix actually of 200 grams of whole eggs, 100 grams of egg yolks, 50 grams of heavy cream, and 50 grams of milk. And then just like that. And then after that, you go gently just to the top, not to the layer, just where the shiny part. Just like that. So you go all over the croissant just like that. So basically when the croissant are poof, they're wet, what I do, I leave outside for 5-10 minutes. Like that they become dry. When it's dry, I'm adding actually the egg wash. Adding the egg wash. And personally, what I did to get the shiny baking afterward, I leave all the egg wash only once. And then I leave outside for 15 minutes max. The egg wash is going to have a crust on top of it. And then after you bake it, for me, like a convection oven, the best is 340 Fahrenheit or 170 degrees Celsius. Again, it depends the size of the croissant. It goes to 16 to 20 minutes until like you have a nice correction, the layers and all that. Okay. I showed the face off. So when it's baked, as you see, I did some pain au raisin, some croissant, and the pain au chocolat. As was I mentioned, you see the temperature, you see all the layers. You see all the layers is because I control the temperature, the dough on the mixing. Then I put in a freezer, refrigerate overnight, And then after I control also the temperature of the butter to the lamination with the dough, which is very important, like I mentioned. And the butter, you can see all the layers, and it's very important, like this one, like one double turn or one single turn. And you see the big layers actually for that. And you will have a perfect baking, perfect product, and the consistency. If I'm using, of course, the regular butter, of course, you can make some croissant with the regular butter, but there will not be rice as much. You don't have like all the consistency like the tourage butter. Okay, that is great for that. Okay, something for the pain au chocolat, the layers is very, very important. And then after that, so I baked those one this morning actually, and it's ready to go. That's it. Any question, please?
You have two questions, Eric. One question is about your egg wash recipe. Can you tell us what your egg wash recipe is?
Yes, please. It's 200 grams of egg yolk, whole eggs. Sorry, 100 grams of whole eggs. Then is 50 grams of egg yolk, 50 grams of heavy cream, and 50 grams of milk.
One more question from Emmanuel. In the puff pastry, what is the amount of tourage butter that you suggest for every kilo of flour?
Okay. I don't have that on the top of my mind, actually. If you can send an email or whatever to communicate, I will let him know. Okay.
That's all. Any other questions? Oh, here's one. What is the percent of cacao powder on the flour when you do a chocolate croissant?
Okay. Usually I do 10%. 10% cocoa powder. You need to do like you need to create a paste with the milk actually. And then so you make your croissant dough or pain au chocolat dough, and then you go to add a paste at the end of the mixing. So of course, you go to add more liquid, like water, more water. And on the sugar, for 1 kilo, I suggest to go to 130 grams for 1 kilo of flour, because the cocoa powder is pretty intense, and that you could have a great result. Also, the fat content of the butter, maybe less butter on to the dough, and you have a better result for that.
We have a couple more questions. Is the presentation part over?
Yes, I think so.
Okay, I want to join you up here.
Please.
Okay, so we will continue answering questions, but I want to wrap this up a little bit if some of you have to go. First of all, big thank you to you, Chef Eric.
Thanks.
I know you've been preparing for this for many days, so we appreciate everything you've told us. Yeah. I learned a lot. We hope that you learned a lot too. You'll see those evaluations coming soon. And then the quiz question for the second board is, at what temperature does the butter need to be when you bring it to room temperature? What temperature are you looking for? What range? Eric mentioned a range earlier. So enter those in the chat, and the first person to get that right, we'll send this to you. The other thing that I wanted to mention is that if you use Belmont butter, one thing that comes with Belmont butter, which is amazing, is Chef Eric's support and expertise. So if you have trouble with the butter, if you have any questions, any problems, if you need him to come to your bakery or to call you or talk to you through some principles in using the butter, that comes with the butter. So that's a huge advantage. If you're intimidated by using Belle de Tourage for the first time, don't worry about it. You have Eric's support. He's there to help you out. Okay, so if you want to hear the answers to some of these questions, stay on. Otherwise, that's it for the formal part of the presentation. So thank you very much for joining us. And I'm going to go read a couple more questions.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, please.
Someone asked if the recording will be available. Yes, it will be available. And one question came up. François asked, could you repeat the timing before and after the egg washing?
Okay. So when is proof, you leave 10 minutes outside, just is no more humidity on top of the croissant, the pain au chocolat, and then you egg wash, and you will be able to egg wash. And then, personally, what I do to use, as you can see, the shine, to get the shiny, actually, it's not the syrup, actually. I leave the croissant, the pain au chocolat outside after when it's egg washed for 15 minutes outside. And you're going to see like a skin on top with the egg wash, and then you will be able to bake it. And then after, it will be shiny, just like that.
Perfect. Someone asked if you can cut the croissant in half so that they can see the layers on the inside.
Yes, of course. Here we go. Oh, sorry. You see?
Thank you, chef.
You see the lamination is great. You have the bubble. It's airy, light, and... Let's go for that.
Great. David asked, what are the best colors to do bi-color croissants?
Okay, I suggest to use the gel color.
Can you repeat that?
The gel color.
Gel?
The gel color.
Okay. And let's see. Rachmani asked, is it possible to add sugar to the egg mixture?
You can, but it's not necessary. Why? Because again, adding some milk into, so you have already the coloration. So if you're adding sugar or salt, it's going to be more dark, the croissant. You don't want that. You want like a golden, actually, a golden crust, actually, which is great, the color. And you see all the layers, so, and you want the crispiness and all that. So you don't want the sugar to the even the salt, you don't want that to the egg wash, for sure.
Okay, great. Question from Gary. What defines fully proofed? Is it defined by a volume increase or separated layers?
So it's defined by the volume. And also when I should show, when you see the chipan, when you check the chipan, they're moving like a little bit. Those one has been in the fridge for 1 hour, so now we're set, but they're moving like a little bit, you know, in one piece, and they're ready for the proofing. As you can, I don't know if you see, I wash this one actually, and you see the, it's like a skin of egg wash. So I know it's ready to bake and will be shiny at the end. It's like, actually when we do the puff pastry, the king cakes, what we do, we egg wash and we leave outside until it's crust, you have the same result, the same idea for the croissant, the pain au chocolat, etc.
Right. Question from many.
Yes.
How many hours of resting the dough between folds is recommended?
Okay. Between the, again, if you do like a small amount of dough, personally, if you did respect actually the temperature of the dough and the butter during the folding, you can give the one double turn and one single turn in one shot. If you have a big batch and all that, it goes in a freezer for 15 minutes. That's fine, 15 minutes. And then after you do the single turn, and then you rest for 30 minutes in a freezer, and it goes back to the fridge for half an hour, something like that.
Noof asked a question. His question is, what is the best way to bake the croissants? Is it using silicone mats or baking sheets?
It could be parchment paper, silicone mat, doesn't matter.
Okay. And after you proof, do you recommend chilling?
So that is a good question, actually. It's a good question. So, sometimes, when you have like many speed rack, actually, when everything is ready and you don't have time to egg wash and you want to control, actually, it doesn't overproof and all that, what I suggest, you put a speed rack or chipan to the fridge for 15 minutes. And it's going to stop the proofing time. And then after, you will be able to egg wash and to bake it.
Another question here, chef. What is the reason behind butter leaking during baking?
Okay. During baking, okay. It might be also by quality of the butter. Also, it might be also during the proofing time, maybe the proofing temperature was too high, for sure. And again, if you're using like a regular butter, of course, it's going to link during baking, that for sure. Because again, you don't have a higher melting point. It's a lot of water, like I said, content inside. This one is, the Tourage butter is a low water content. So I don't have like any butter leaking or whatever. Again, it can be the quality or the regular butter for that.
Okay, that is it for questions. That's okay. It. Okay. I think that's all the questions. If anything else comes up, you will get my email address when I email you for the evaluation. So please do send us back that evaluation. So thanks a lot for joining us. Okay. And we run these webinars a couple of times a month now on different subjects. So we hope to see you at the next one. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for everything. Bye. Bye, everyone.